whole new zingo or lingo, whatever vocabulary, whatever words you want to use, has come up in the last 20 years in the world. And one of them, the most popular, is stress. You've heard of this word, all of you. And around this stress, there are a lot of other words which have come up. Things which were not known to people, like depression, like mental disorders. And on the periphery has emerged a whole billion-dollar industry to keep people mentally healthy. These are pharmaceuticals, these are self-help books, self-help gurus, and whatnot. It's a huge industry. How is this supported? This is supported by some data. World Health Organization says by 2020, every fourth Indian will be taking an antidepressant or an anti-anxiety drug. This is what they said about 10 years back. Last year they said that 36% of Indians are depressed. And believe me, antidepressants and anti-anxiety drugs are the most prescribed drugs. Some people say depression is the number two killer in the world. Now, amongst all this mess, you really don't know what is the truth. So it's worthwhile to examine that what is mental health, because obviously, what do we all strive for? We strive for being healthy and being mentally healthy. But if 36% people in a country are not well, it's a very, very sinister sign. So I think it's not only a prerogative of psychiatrists and mental health professionals and psychologists and the policy makers and the pharmaceutical people to know what is the truth. It's a prerogative of everybody to know it. This is the truth and fact and statistics. If you believe statistics is truth, then this is the truth. But on the other hand, there's a whole lot of confusion in it, even in the basic definitions. So what we are going to do in next half an hour, 40 minutes, is just trace it back and let's see what happens. What is mental health and what is mental illness? And how do mental health professionals perceive it? How does the society perceive it? Because obviously nothing works in isolation. None of them is an island. So it has to be an interactive thing. So let's go back. Let's go back to the farthest point in history, the first sign where we know what we call, you know, the common word which is used in India for mental illness? What is it?
Pagal.
Pagal. Pagal ka translation is mad. So I'm not talking about mental illness, that we'll see. What a mental illness is, a word which came in the last 50 years, courtesy us and courtesy people, activists and all that. But what was being used in literature and history was a word called madness. Let's go back to the first sign of madness. Do you know the man here? Two men? Who are they? Lord Krishna and Arjun. Imagine that this is not mythology. This was a story, there was a war. There was a man called Arjun who was the best warrior of that time. The whole war hinged on that man's performance. Right? And he goes there and he says, I'll not fight. What was he undergoing? And what did Krishna do then? What did he do?
Counseling.
Yeah. That was the... Even if you go further, you will find more stories. But let's take this as a starting point. Because some people say it's mythology. And even if it was true, it was happening at the beginning of this 5,000 years of history we know. We don't know the history of 2 lakh years. We know the history of 5,000 years. So this man suddenly went into what? What happened to him? It has happened to all of us at some point of the time. Exams, entrance, competition.
Depression.
It was one acute depression. He just... And if you read this text called Gita, and read the first chapter, you will know what was happening. Arjun was saying, my hands are going loose, they are shivering and I'm sweating and my mind is going blank, I'm getting dizzy. All a sign of an acute panic attack. You listen to somebody who is having a panic attack or acute depression, somebody wants to run away, will tell you the same story. So that was the first described acute attack of depression and the first psychotherapy in action. So Krishna didn't take himself, come to my chamber. let's sit across the table on the couch and talk. He said, boss, let's do psychotherapy here itself. And he did a wonderful psychotherapy. That psychotherapy still remains the best. But if there was a madness, that was madness. There was a method in it. That madness was not very deviant. It was in a war field. So you are being asked to fight, you don't fight. You get into certain physical symptoms, your mind just gives way. And there's a man, luckily, who is sitting in front of your chariot, who turns back and says, not everybody is so lucky. Not all Arjuns have Krishna by their side. Huh? So that means it was well known even then. People didn't call it madness. But if all these symptoms are put into a modern classificatory system, Arjun will get a label. Like we are used to giving labels to everything. Read this. Let's come to Greece. Socrates is one of the oldest philosophers. I'm just telling you what has been the viewpoint over time towards what we call madness today. So acute depression was not called a madness. Krishna told him to fight, that this is a fine temporary thing, it will go off. Panic attacks still remain the same, by the way. Socrates said that madness is nothing to be ashamed of. All great things come out of madness. Right? Madness comes from God, whereas sober sense is merely human. And you all have heard the word called, is a very thin line between a genius and a madman. Some people remain on the both sides of it. One has to choose which side. And this is, some people prefer madness. If at all there is anything called madness. So there was a whole lot of people who took pride in the madness. Socrates, Gibran, Shakespeare has written everywhere. You see Hamlet, you see Macbeth, everybody. So the big minds of all times, the literature, the philosophers, they never thought ki madness is something which should be thrown out. They actually loved their madness. Nietzsche went psychotic. In our times, Saadat Hasan Manto, the greatest Urdu short story teller, actually had psychotic breakdown. Vincent Van Gogh, right? John Nash. Now, what has happened over time is that these people started getting labels. And once society started giving them labels, then this whole concept of psychiatry and mental health and everything started. Let's see what are the labels they received. First of all these people were considered, once they started thinking about this as an illness, then all labels started. Human beings are very fond of giving labels. They cannot live without labels because labels give a certain framework. Labels give certainty. If we don't label anything, it's all free. Then what is the problem? The problem is uncertainty. That will keep creating anxiety. Everybody wants to have a certain mindset to know the future. What the next step is going to be. If you are just sent out in the open and said there is no label, you go and do what you want. It will be a very, very discomforting and disturbing experience for most people, unless you have really trained your mind to be like that, into free-flowing area. But that's very difficult. These are some of the labels. You all have heard this. Insane. We still use this word, right? We don't use this word in psychiatry anymore. Insane is against what? Sanity. Is sanity defined? I'm just throwing some questions, keep thinking.
No.
When sanity is not defined, you're still calling somebody insane. Doesn't matter. Lunatic. You heard this word called lunatic? Lunatic asylums. We don't use this word. Lunatic asylum came from what? Lunatics came from what? He's a raving lunatic. People used to say about Hitler. Raving lunatic. Lunatic came from what? There was an observation by some great people that with the lunar cycle, some people used to become disturbed on a full moon day. They almost equated it with like sea tides. There were 2-3 days in a month where these people will be disturbed. At that time, there were no other biological explanations. So, what they thought was that because it's a full moon, and there's all this, they did not even know magnetic field at that time. They just knew that it's a full moon and there's a disturbance. So, this corroborative research, you corroborate a set of facts with the other facts, is still the hardcore research method in psychiatry today also. So, a lot of research which goes into psychiatry and mental health and all that, sometimes you will really wonder what is happening. Nothing is happening. It's the same lunatic thing going on. Full moon, illness. We find it here that five people who put the first left foot forward, fall. I'm just throwing it. But somebody may really find it. You should walk with your right foot forward first. Because you put left foot, the chances are you will stumble. This type of thing, corroboration, it may not be the best way, but that is the only way. Abnormal against what?
Abnormal.
Big question. Big question. Mad, we all know. In some societies, these mad people were not considered as mad. They were actually considered as bad. Have we evolved from that? Yes or no? I don't think we have evolved. If you just look what was happening in our country few days back in Delhi, we are really not sure those people were mad or bad. One of them died also. How to decide? But then their systems evolved. There are certain things with the intent. If there is an intent, you call them bad. When there is no intent, you call them mad. Right? So, a poor man who lifts up a bread from a shop and a rich person who lifts up a watch from a shopping mall, who is mad and who is bad? Have you ever thought? A lot of film stars were caught in Dubai lifting up watches and putting in their purse. But a person who steals a bread, who doesn't have food, who can you decide? It's very difficult. It's very difficult. Really, I'm telling you. Just why I'm telling you all this, that it's very easy to tell you how we decide this is mentally ill and this is, one of you may come and say, I'm having this. Now, if I'm a good psychiatrist, I will not take time and put a label on you, and that is not the best way. But it's very difficult to decide. Very difficult to decide what is what. Because a person who lifts up, a rich person who lifts up, is called a kleptomaniac. Right? That they have a compulsive stealing. This person who lifts up is hungry. Act is the same in different context, but the context decides. Now, this is the big thing, context. But do we work on context is the question. The same panic attack for Arjun was a context. But a panic attack while you are coming out of the lift is a different context. Alright. There is no big deal in coming out of the lift or going into the lift. But you go into the lift and you have a panic attack. Now after all this lunatic asylum and activism, and some people thought that, and they thought it correctly, that why denigrate people by telling them that you are lunatic or inferior or whatever. Alright. We started calling it mentally ill. So now there is a whole lot of activism which is going on, which I don't know what will come out in next 20 years. Like, let me give you an example. All this is children who have deficits, like mental retardation and all this, these are all diagnoses, but people have stopped calling them as deficient children or deficit or subnormal. They started calling them mentally challenged. Alright. Yeah, I mean, you can call them mentally challenged. I don't even call them mentally challenged. What is the problem? But because, I'll tell you why we call them. We will discover. Why have we started calling people like this and that and... What is normal? Can anybody define? What is normal?
the characteristics which are shown by majority of the population.
Right. So, is normal, what is statistically normal?
Yeah, it is statistically
normal. Alright. Any other definition?
Actually, there is no definition.
Yeah, last lecture I had a sentence which was a very crazy sentence. A lot of people will kill me for that. They said normal sanity is insanity. Normal sanity is insanity because most of the time you are trying to do what others do. So, if you are trying to do what others do, you are insane or sane? It's a $1 million question. I am not telling this here, I tell it to psychiatrists also. They may outcast me someday, but never bother. Think over, I'll throw more questions today than answers. But you, because you're going to run this country, someday you will be making policies and all that. So if you keep this thorn in your head, someday you may really modify things. Okay, I agree your definition. This is what we are taught. Okay, let me take an example of intelligence. You all know what IQ test is? IQ test is the mental age upon your real age into 100. Agreed? This is just a number. If I say you have a IQ of 140 and I have a IQ of 70, what does it mean? What does it mean? Nothing. Does it mean anything? You have your life, I have my life. You may make a rocket, I may make a chai. How does it matter? How does it matter? It doesn't matter, but you know what happened? At the beginning of 20th century and even before that, 19th, this drama was used to control people. Psychiatry has always been a big tool in the hands of politicians, psychologists also. This tool was used because you see, this is the bell-shaped curve. One is standard deviation, two standard deviation, all population comes into that. Right, so normal is in between. Then less and less, right. This was being used by some people to control the black population. That's how they came to it. They said they have less IQ. Like Dalits were told they have a less IQ. Who said there is a less IQ? When you do this test, if I am not paying attention to it, or if I am anxious, I will perform badly. And they are heavily verbally loaded tests which were done initially, right? Heavily verbally loaded. So, if I have not been given a chance to develop my language, I will not perform well. So, after some time, after 50 years of all this drama, some people started devising performance tests. But fine, if you are verbally you are not good, let's perform. And now anyway, it has evolved to more or less sensible level. So, IQ tests are normally now used for certification only. In my last 10 years, I haven't bothered to get an IQ test done for anybody. Even when they say it's mental retardation, I say, oh, it's, damn it, don't bother. Because what will you do? The moment you get an IQ test, you know what happens. This is the source of all drama. The source of the drama is that if I do IQ test and I tell you that you have an IQ of 80, this information will be in your head for life. And the moment I tell you your IQ is 80 and Albert Einstein's IQ was 160, you will start comparing. You unnecessarily get into a loop of inferiority, complex, I can't do this, I can't do that, and this, then that drama. And what will happen is that you may have a potential, but it will not work. I am just telling you in isolation about intelligence. So, now what the theory has changed, they say there is a guy called Gardner. Gardner said, why are you bothered about IQ and all that? There are 7 types of intelligence and there are many more types of intelligences we don't know. Some people are motor intelligence. Motor intelligence means they can use their body very well. Dancers, athletes, cricketers. Some people use their music intelligence. All great musicians. The music sense is wonderful. You may have your visual intelligence much more developed than your verbal intelligence, or you may have a verbal, even interpersonal and intrapersonal. Some people have a very good skill of solving others' problem. Politicians, they have such good interpersonal skills. Some people have very good intrapersonal skills. So there are a whole lot of type of intelligences. Why do you have to have a unitary construct of single IQ? It means that in somebody, one type of intelligence may be much more developed than the other type. That is what is being understood now, which is fine. And this is all the result of all this churning which has gone in last 40 years in our heads. Because we also don't like all that. Why blame people? Why tell them this and that? But anyway, that's how the world goes. So if it can happen in intelligence, it can happen in a lot of other things. Your own information taken out of context can be used to label. These are the confusion which actually prevailed in the minds of people who have made classificatory system. And I'll just bring you to 2013, what is happening. We are amidst a huge crisis right now, the whole psychiatry. Okay, so what is mental health? This is a definition by WHO. It's not just the absence of mental disorder. It is defined as a state of well-being in which every individual realizes his or her own potential, can cope with the normal stresses of life, can work productively and fruitfully, and is able to make a contribution to her or his community. All right. What it doesn't talk about, it doesn't talk about what? When and how? We all have, if you apply this definition onto yourself, there would have been occasions when we would have not been mentally healthy. Because there are times when we are not realizing our potential. There are times when we are not able to cope with normal stress. We all go crazy, if at all there is something called crazy. But does that, yeah.
These definitions looks more or less like that they are taking human beings as robots, like a machine.
Absolutely. WHO is being paid dollars for all this.
Oh.
The problem is that people, that's what I'm saying. Why I'm challenging this whole concept, I'm not challenging in this lecture, but most of us are challenging these concepts because these are definitions which have been made putting into a larger frame of life. Whatever dimensions life is in, and therein lies the whole problem, because we haven't evolved a perfect system of, there are reasons for it, and as we go along you will know why this definition has been evolved. Now this is mental disorders, if that is mental health, this is mental disorder. It comprises a broad range of problems with different symptoms. However, they are generally characterized by some combination of abnormal thoughts, emotions, behavior and relationship with others. By these two definitions, all of us at some point of time would fall into being mentally ill. But it's not so, because once we started defining mental illness, we also put a tag of duration onto it. Like if you are sad for half a day, we wouldn't call it depression actually. You have to be persistently sad for 2 weeks. Or similarly, if you have a single panic attack, you don't treat it. You have 4 panic attacks in a month, then you treat it. Or if you have such symptoms for 1 month, then you are called this. Okay. So that once in a while you have all this, it will not qualify for a mental illness. How we reach this duration and all is, again, we'll see when we talk of DSM. So, when we don't know what is normal, we don't know what is abnormal, right? So, how do we decide? Are these people who are mentally ill different from us? Are they people who are born from some other species? Are they different? Have they descended from Mars? No. They are like us. Except if you remove their mental illness, aren't they like us? They are. Okay. That means we are no different. Big question. So there are two things which we still don't know. Whether mental illness is on a continuum from healthy, normal, two, there is a little problem, you have adjustment reaction, you're ditched by your girlfriend, boyfriend, you go into a tizzy for 2 weeks, it's an adjustment reaction, you bounce back. 100% of the people who face such situation will go into depression. So it's a normal reaction. So somewhere between that. And then to a minor illness, and then to, is it this? From mental health to illness, that all of us have a potential of what a fully mentally ill person has. We may be at 10, he may be at 100. Or is it discrete? Are they different people? Are they people who were not like us? But if they are not like us, they are in our families. Even if they are not like us, they are in our families. Are those families different where there is a mental illness? Or are they in our families? I guess they are in our families. They are no stigmatized, separate families that this family will have mental illness and this will not. Because there is such a widespread gene pool, which is in all of us. 90% genes are the same. From our African grandmother, they are the same genes. So when the gene pool is the same, then the tendency to have illness is the same. And this is something which is very concrete. So who is ill? Statistics. Who is this man? Was he ill? Was he ill? When whole England was in overcoat, this guy was moving with a shawl and chappal, not even a sock. And you know this famous story. He went to meet King George, right, in his, this is slightly underdressed, when he's slightly overdressed, he has a shawl. And he walks up and he said, Mr. Gandhi, somebody said, Mr. Gandhi, don't you think you are underdressed to meet the king? He said, doesn't matter, he's overdressed for me. Was he ill? Big question. Outside the statistics, is out of even that 2 standard deviation, the last tip of something is lying there. No, this is very important to think over sometime in your life. Can mental health be defined by a unitary construct? Let me give you an example. I gave you one example of stealing. The other example is, if suddenly one of us removes our clothes and starts wandering on the street with just one leaf to cover your below waist, what will happen? In this campus, I'll tell you the destination. The destination is health center, counseling office, health center, me or Sanjay Mahendru, or mental hospital. Right? You go to a place called Bastar in MP. They still live like that. Forget Bastar. 10 years back, I used to drive from Agra to Jaipur, near Bharatpur, where there is a bird sanctuary. Women in the whole 2-3 villages, they don't wear anything on the torso. Today, 10 years back.
Africa?
In India, I am telling Bharatpur. Bharatpur is just next door. But if Rakhi Sawant does it in Mumbai, the whole censor board will start. What is an LD? What is NLD? And what is mental health? Somebody doing, a poor man doing an obscene gesture on the street, is mentally ill? We always accept. What about the item number songs in Bollywood? Are they mentally unhealthy or healthy? If they are mentally unhealthy and we pay 2 crore rupees to them, then there is something wrong with us then. So, it's very, very difficult to define. In a Western culture, touching feet, they will not accept it. In our culture, we don't accept, we don't touch feet, we still get a slap. I'm 48 and I hear from my 70-year-old uncle, ki, you kids have a problem, huh? Buddy grown up beyond your boots. I still hear, this is what happens. So, what I'm trying to tell you, lot of mental health issues are context driven. It is a fallacy on the part of people who diagnose, it's a fallacy on the part of people who treat, to call everything a illness. like for me, if you ask me, if somebody has broken up in a love affair, I wouldn't call them mentally ill and depression and all. I know it. This should happen. Because this happened to Ghalib. So he wrote a lot of poetry. You don't go and treat Ghalib, na? Ghalib was depressed, he was alcohol dependent. Alright. Had you treated him, would this poetry would have come out? John Nash was called to World Psychiatry Association Madrid conference. And he stood up and he said, "Thanks, you treated me, but please don't take away my creativity. If my illness is my creativity, let it be."
Actually, I have seen John Nash also.
Yes.
And once when John Nash was first in the hospital, one of his mathematician's friend came and told him that above all, you, a person who has dedicated his life to logic and perfection, could say that you are seeing those sort of visions.
Mm-hmm.
And John Nash only said, "The mathematics comes to me in the same way as those visions."
Absolutely, absolutely.
So, Srinivasa Ramanuja,
yes,
everything in dreams.
Everything. All big things come there. Socrates said it, no? It's a gift from God. So, again, I'm saying, don't get mad, but what I'm trying to say is all context driven. You go to nude camps, they live nude in a certain area. You go and tell them that, "Why are you doing this?" They'll come say, "Why are you doing this?" Osho, you know Rajneesh, he was asked, "Why are you keeping a beard?" He said, "I'm living naturally, you are living unnaturally by shaving." So what I'm trying to tell you that there's no answer to it. It's blurred. So on what basis do we decide somebody is ill? If it is contraction, if it is mentally healthy, if after taking dope you are supposed to go crazy, and what is abnormal in that? Because cannabis use is very common in villages and all that. Right? In your hostel it is not. In eastern UP villages, the mothers used to give a bit of morphine to the kids so that they sleep in the daytime and they can go and work in the field. Today, if you tell this, so that means it is time and space and everything decides what is healthy. But we are still there, we have butted our foot in, and we'll decide. So what are the facts? Let's see. I'm telling you the normal facts. Everybody has a unique blueprint of personality, conditioned by nurture. Agreed? No confusion in this. Stress is inherent to living. If you don't have stress, you will not perform. But stress, again, is good stress and bad stress. What we make of stress determines quality of life. Simply. There is some stress, your performance improves. The stress goes beyond a point, your performance drops. No. Between this confusion, this whole billion-dollar industry is making money. Everybody. All the gurus, all self-help things, all yoga. Barack Obama has said that yoga is a good spiritual exercise and it is nobody's copyright and all that. So, what I am saying that what is inherent and being given to you by nature by a simple mathematics called a Yerkes-Dodson curve. Simple mathematics. Stress till a certain level will improve your performance. Beyond a certain level, it will fall. Simple. There is a good stress, there is a bad stress. What you make out of your life determines your quality of life. And you don't need rocket science to understand this. Simple. What are the challenges to living in normal life? Cognitive aberration. We all have, you know, understand cognitive aberrations. But we all have faulty logics. Right? Cognitive aberrations come by selective abstraction. You have given a set of data, you will see what you want and then get worried. Right? Like you are being told that you will, small kids or school kids, report card. The report card is the huge selective abstraction. What is the report card? Nobody knows. But then what you abstract the report card is determining my passing. From here starts the problem. Passing becomes more important, knowledge gains a second hand. This is cognitive aberration. And unfortunately, cognitive aberration is present not in kids. They don't know all this. It's present in the teachers and parents. Minimization and magnification. What should not be paid attention to? We bother too much about it. Right? And what should be paid attention? We don't bother. This is called minimize. So, these are normal things, generalizations. The specific thing is generally all hall one drinks alcohol. What? 30% would drink and make hangama. So, but those 30% can ride over. Politicians. This is a typical thing we do, cognitive aberration. All politicians are bad. Ah, you can't do this, please. For God's sake. 540 MPs can't be bad. Huh? They are human beings like us. There will be hardly 40 or 60 or 100 at max who will be real corrupt and bad. These 100 becomes a huge number. Rest 400 who are poor people who are working. This is generalization. Actually, this is generalization. Everybody is bad. Now, this induces anxiety. Suppression of emotion and thought. We all do this, isn't it? We have to, otherwise we wouldn't survive. What are the sources of all this trouble to normal people? Let's look at the normal problems, then we'll see whether we turn into mentally ill. Self, we are a problem to ourselves. There's no bigger problem in earth than me. Right? There's a great poet, Surdas. You heard of Surdas? He used to write poetry on Krishna. He wrote that, you what God are you? Till this date you have been saving all the very minor puppies. Save me, then I'll know you are a god. So, this is in the mind of human beings from ages. Work is a problem always. And you have to work to earn your livelihood. It's not a good way of living. Nevertheless, relationships are meant for problems. Sometimes support.